So this morning, we are talking about the laws of the kingdom. Okay, laws of the kingdom. In other words, we're dealing with some of the principles that operate when you become a member of the body of Christ. Okay, everything in life operates according to some inherent laws. Everything in life. There are some inherent laws that the designers put in place. And those inherent laws are put in there so that they can allow that particular object to operate the way the person who designed it wants it to operate. There is a particular law that operates in a vehicle, in a car, and that law is that it must operate on a gasoline. Even if you don't like the idea, if you think that gasoline is too expensive, if you think that gasoline smells very badly, if you think that gasoline should not be used in a car, and then you now pick a car that you bought and decide to pour some water into it and decide to drive, I can assure you that no matter how much you hate gasoline, your car is not going anywhere. Okay? Because the person who designed it, what they have in mind, the limitations that they put in place is that the car has to operate using what? A gasoline. The same thing in life. You might, I've said it here several times, you might not like the law of gravity, but that is the way God has designed this particular earth where we live right now. That anyone who lives here is subject to what? Subject to the law of gravity. If you don't like it, go and jump from Batman's tower and find out what will happen to you. The point we are making is this. Everything in life operates according to some inherent law. And those inherent laws are some basic characteristics that are built into those laws. And those characteristics, number one, is that inherent law relates to the nature of the object it applies to. The laws that are in place in the life of any particular individual, any particular object, relates to that particular object. Okay, so when you talk about the laws of, when you talk about the laws that operate for people, for fishes, it is designed to operate around the place where the fish lives in. Every fish has to live in water. The fish that say, I don't like water. I don't like it because it's too wet. I don't like water because I don't want to live in it. So I decide to change my mind. I want to live on the ground. What happens to that fish? That fish is dead. The point we are making is that every inherent law relates to the nature of the object that it applies to. This inherent law has to do with the nature of that particular thing. Birds fly. That's what they do. If birds decide to walk like human beings, they have a problem because they are not designed to walk like human beings. The law inside of them is designed them to be able to fly. Number two, inherent law are set, they set conditions of operation. In other words, when the person who designed this microphone designed it, there was a condition that is set in there, and that is that it is supposed to amplify my voice. If I take this microphone and I now decide to use it for a hammer, what happens? It no longer functions the way it was designed to function. In other words, inherent laws set the conditions of operation. This inherent law exists to make sure that the condition of operation is carried out consistently, equitably, without prejudice. Anyone who applies that law must apply to everybody. So it doesn't matter whether you are white or black. It doesn't matter whether you are short or tall. If you are going to use this microphone, you will have to speak into it. Right? You will have to speak into it. The fact that I'm a tall man doesn't mean I can keep my microphone at the back. It will not function. The point we are making is that the law is designed to make sure that the condition of operation is equitable, is general to everybody. Not only that, inherent laws guarantees optimal performance. What does that mean? It means that as long as I obey the laws that is set for this particular microphone, it will do what it was designed to do. It will amplify my voice. If a bird flies in the air, it will fly properly. If a fish swims in the water, it will swim properly. If the fish decide to leave the water and start walking on the land, it will have problem. If the birds decide to leave the sky and go inside the water, it's going to have problem. The idea is that inherent laws guarantees optimal performance. Number four now, observing inherent law determines your own effectiveness. In other words, if you want to be effective in life, you have to obey the laws that are set in place. You have to obey the laws that make things work. If you live in the U.S. here and you decide to obey the laws of Africa, you might have problem with the people here in the U.S. because the laws here are different from the laws back home. If you live in Africa, you decide to come and obey the laws of Africa, obey the law of America in Africa, you are going to have problem. The observing inherent law determines the effectiveness. As long as the birds continue to fly in the sky, they are going to be effective. You cannot beat a bird that is flying in the sky. The only problem is that the birds will start having problem when you decide to begin to act like a human being. Or when men begin to act like animals, that's when they have problems. But when men act like men, they are effective. So the laws, what? The laws, observing inherent laws, determine effectiveness. And then number five, obedience to inherent laws ensures success and progress. When you obey inherent laws, you are ensured success and you are ensured progress. Okay? Violating these inherent laws, therefore, brings disorder and dysfunction. And that is why a man who does not know the use or does not know the proper function of his wife will abuse her. If you don't know the proper function of Tylenol, you are going to abuse it. If you don't know the proper function of anything, you are going to abuse it. Okay? So violation of inherent law leads to disorder and dysfunction. And that is why when you see people violate societal laws, when you are driving on the freeway and you decide to go 100 miles per hour, you are violating the law. And if you don't take time, you will cause disorder, you will cause dysfunction. So violating inherent law does what? Leads to disorder and dysfunction. Now, inherent laws, finally, protects and guides the proper functioning of life. If you obey the laws, it guides proper functioning, and it protects and guides proper functioning of life. In other words, if everybody does what they are supposed to do, life will be easy for everyone. Problem starts when you think that you are above the law, or when I think I'm above the law. That's when trouble starts. But if everybody lives their life the way they are supposed to live it, everybody know life will function the way it was supposed to function. Now these are the laws that are built into creation and every aspect of human life. Every society is governed by law. No human society can survive without any law. Because if you come into this place, there's a law of decorance, of proper behavior. There's a law of proper attitude. When you come into this place and you feel that you are above the law, and when somebody is ministering and you are deciding to create your own special ministration session, we are going to have disorder, we are going to have chaos. So no human society can survive without law. We are all seated here today and we are subject to the laws of this country. And as Christians, you are also subject to the laws of God if you are born again. Okay? So everyone here who is a Christian, everyone here who is born again, are subject to two laws. The laws of man, which is the society that we live in, and the laws of God, which is, as a Christian, the laws of heaven. The Bible makes us to understand the book of Philippians chapter 3, reading from verse number 20. It said that for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly await for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, we are not just citizens of the country where we are living in, we are also citizens of heaven. So we are subject to the laws of man, we are subject also to the laws of God. The question is, why do we have laws in the first place? Why do you need laws? Why do we need to be able to have a particular system of governance of ourselves? Why do we need laws in the first place? Number one, law enforces and protects the standards by which the society operates. If there is no standard, everybody will do whatever they want. If there are no laws, everybody will make up their own laws. In the book of Judges, I think in Judges, the Bible makes us to understand there that in the days where there was no law, everybody does whatever they like. Everybody became a law unto themselves. If you wake up this morning and you say, this is the way I want to do it, nobody can stop you because there's no law to govern you. So law enforces and protects the standard by which the society operates. Number two, law defines the duties of the people. It is the law of this country that you have to pay taxes. It is the laws of this country that April 15, you have to file your taxes with the IRS. That is the law of the land. It tells you, it defines the duties of the people. Number three, the law protects the rights of the people. In other words, you have a right as a citizen of this country. You have a right as a citizen of a society to be able to enjoy some benefit. And the law stipulates that. Number four, the law clarifies the expectations of government. In other words, when you are within a particular body of believers, when you are within a particular society, the government expects certain things from you. And that expectation is spelled out in the law. And then number five or number six, the law prescribes penalties for violators. In other words, if you don't do what you are supposed to do, that is why we have the men in blue. Okay? That's why you have some people who will make sure they put you where you're supposed to be, where you belong. The law prescribes penalties for violators. Now, please understand that these laws, these attributes of the law, they apply not only to the physical world, they also apply to the spiritual world. In other words, just like you have laws in America, you also have laws in the kingdom. Just like the law protects the citizens of this country, the laws of God also protect the people of God. Just like if you violate the laws of this country, you will suffer consequences. The same thing, if you violate the laws of God, you will suffer consequences. So these laws, the attributes of the law, they apply both to secular and to spiritual societies. Now, many of you have heard about what is called the Ten Commandments. Anyone here who have never heard about the Ten Commandments? Everybody here, at least at one point in time, have heard about the Ten Commandments. And if you have never heard about the Ten Commandments, and you were here this morning when we were reading our Bible, that is the Ten Commandments that you have just read. Okay? So we have all heard about the Ten Commandments. And these are the laws that were given by God to his people to determine how his people will not only relate with him, but how they will relate to one another. Those were the parameters. Those were the law that God has set in place so that we can relate to him and relate to one another. These Ten Commandments are the basic framework for life within the kingdom of God. They are the parameters that God says, okay, this is how I want you to relate to me. And this is how I want you to relate to one another. It defines the condition for a fruitful relationship with God and with man. It tells both parties that these are the things you can do and these are the things you cannot do. That's what the Ten Commandments is all about. Like every law, if you follow them, you get the benefits. And if you violate them, you will suffer the consequences. The question now this morning is this. You came to church to listen to the Bible. You came to church to hear about something good, something uplifting. Why are we talking about the laws? I mean, if I were in your shoes, I'll be asking, what is this preacher talking about? Why are we talking about the law? The first thing is that we are talking about the law because your effectiveness as a Christian is a function of your understanding of what it takes to walk with God. How effective you are as a Christian, how good you are as a Christian, what you will benefit in the kingdom of God is a function of your understanding of what it takes to walk with God. If you don't know what it takes to walk with God, it will be very difficult for you to fulfill the condition of walking with God. If you don't know what it takes to walk with God, it will be very difficult for you to benefit from that relationship. It's just like a man and a woman who get married, and both of them have no idea what it means to be married. They have no idea what it means to be husband and wife. What do you think will happen to that relationship? There's definitely going to be chaos. Because when you think that the man knows what he's supposed to do, the man has no idea. And the woman also has no idea. The same thing, if you are in the kingdom, if you are a child of God, you need to know what it takes to walk with God. That is why we're talking about it. Number two, we're talking about it because benefiting from your walk with God requires you to know what it takes to walk with him. If you want to benefit from it, if you want to enjoy your relationship with God, if you want to be able to see that that relationship produces the desired result, you need to know what it takes. What are the things that God likes? What are the things that God does not like? For those of us who have been married for a while, you understand that if you want to get something from your spouse, there are certain things that you have to do. And when you do those things, they will give you whatever they want. And for those of us who have kids, you know, when your kids are about to get something from you, there are certain things, there are some buttons that they will push. And once they push those buttons, they know they are going to get what they want. The result is, this is because they understand who they are dealing with. They know what it takes to get the result, and they do it. And the same thing when you're working with God. You have to know what God likes. You have to know what God does not like. And then when you do the things that God likes, what happens is that God is happy with you, and then you get the results that you want. That is why we're talking about it. And then finally, growth and progress in your walk with God is a function of your understanding of how the kingdom operates. how the kingdom of God operates, if you know how that kingdom operates, you'll be able to grow and you'll be able to make progress in that kingdom. You will notice that if you're an immigrant and you come to this country and you begin to do the things that you used to do when you are back home in your country, if you bring it to this place, sometimes it might not work. Sometimes it might not be able to move you forward. And if you don't take time, sometimes it gets you into trouble because you don't understand how this particular society works. But if you understand how this society works, you will know where to get the benefits. You will know where to how to apply the law. You will know where to go for help. You will know who can help you. You will know what to stay away from and what to associate yourself with. Growth and progress in your walk with God is a function of your understanding of how the kingdom of God operates. And the same thing is possible. It's also true. Stagnation in your walk with God results from violating some basic principles of the kingdom. I used to joke with people that in this country, this is a country that never forgives. Okay? America is a country that never forgives. In the sense that if you commit a crime today and you are logged into the system, 20 years from now, as long as you have that thing called social security number and they punch it in, the first thing that will show up is Zoom. You have been a guest at the White House. It will show. Okay? And as soon as it shows up, the first question they will ask you is, have you ever committed felony? Have you ever been jailed? You will answer that question every time. It's a system that does not forgive. So if you violate that law, it might stagnate your life and might cause you not to be able to move forward. The same thing when you are walking with the Almighty God. There are certain things that you will do that will move you forward. There are certain things that you will do that will cut short your progress. And if you don't know those things, you might not be able to move forward. If you don't know those things, you will violate them. And one thing most of us must have heard is, ignorance of the law is not an excuse. I don't know, it's not an excuse. My pastor did not tell me. It's not an excuse. It is your responsibility to find out. So stagnation in your walk with God results from violating the basic principles of the kingdom. So this is the reason why we're talking about this thing this morning. And for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about these things one by one, breaking down the laws of God one by one so that we can understand what is behind it and the things that, the principles behind it. And one of the reasons I do this thing is because if you read the book of Psalm 103, reading from verse number 7, the Bible says that he made his ways known unto Moses, okay? His acts to the children of Israel. We as children of God should not just be seeing the spectacular things that God is doing. We should be able to understand why he does what he does. We should be able to understand why the Lord blesses certain people and why certain people are not blessed. Why certain people receive miracles and why some people don't receive miracles. It's not because God doesn't like you. It's just that there are some basic principles that if you follow, you will get the results. Simple one is the Bible tells us, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measures, pressed down, shaken together, shall men give unto your bosom. It doesn't matter whether you are handsome or ugly. It doesn't matter whether you are tall or short. If you follow that principle, you will get the results. Okay? It's as simple as that. The Bible said, those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you call upon the name of the Lord, you will be saved. The Bible said that those who trust in the name of the Lord shall not be put to shame. If you trust in his name, you will not be put to shame. These are basic things we need to understand. And if you don't put them into practice, you will read about the promise of God, but you might not be able to see the results. And I pray that will not be our portion in Jesus' name. So that's the reason why we're talking about it. So today we are starting with the first law of the kingdom. And if we go to the book of Exodus chapter 20, if you have your Bibles, please open to me here, Exodus 20, or you can simply just pick up the bulletin. Exodus 20, we're reading from verse 1, 2 to number 3, to verse 3. And the Bible says, and God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other God before me. We're going to stop there for today. In other words, God is saying, if you are going to walk with me, if you are going to have a relationship with me, you must recognize the first thing you must do in your walk with the Almighty God. If you are going to walk with me, you must recognize, number one, that I am God. You must recognize that I am the Lord who brought you out of your bondage, who brought you out of whatever situation that you found yourself, who brought you from where you are, from where you have been to where you are right now. I am that God. And as a result of the fact that I am the God who has done these things for you, I do not want you to have any other God before me. In other words, if you are going to walk with me, I should be your one and only God. Is that unreasonable? Huh? Is that unreasonable? If I say yes, I do to my wife, and I told you now that I've said yes, I do to you, I want you to be my one and only, and I want you to recognize me as your one and only. Is that unreasonable? Is it unreasonable for God to say, I don't want you to have another God? Will it be okay for you if you are married to somebody, and then by the day that you do your wedding, after you pronounce all the wedding and everything, you turn to your wife and say, it's okay for you to continue to, you know, go out without your boyfriend, though. I don't have any problem with it. The woman will look at you and say, something is definitely wrong with your head. Something is wrong with you. Because you are supposed to be jealous for your wife or your husband. You are supposed to be passionate. You are supposed to be possessive of them. It doesn't mean that you get to the point where you become obsessive, that you don't allow them to talk to any other person. That's not what we're saying. We're saying that you are supposed to love them to the point that you do not, you know, you do not take it lightly when they violate your marriage covenant. The same thing is what the Lord is talking about. If you are going to walk with me, the Lord is saying, I should be your one and only God. And that is basically the law of sovereign authority. The law of sovereign authority, which is what we're dealing with this morning. This may sound possessive, like I said, may sound restrictive, but the very first condition that God puts to any form of relationship, that if you are going to have a relationship with me, if you are going to be called by my name, if you are going to associate with me, if you are going to be called by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, then you must associate with me and me alone. You must not have any other God apart from me. You must not bow down to any other thing. You must not begin to put any other thing ahead of me. That is what the Lord is saying. And for those who are married, like I said, you do not have your wife and share with several other four or 10 other men. If you do that, that's a different story altogether. It's no longer marriage. The law of sovereignty is based on the exclusive claim that God has on the whole of his creation, because he is the creator and the sustainer of the universe. Okay? And because he created and he sustains the universe, he has the right and he has the power and he has authority over the universe. It's just like when you create something in your own house. In your own house, the house that you are living in right now, no matter how small, no matter how big, you are the king of that particular place. If I come visiting you in that house and I tell you, this is the way you are supposed to arrange your chair, this is where you are supposed to put your TV, you will look at me and say, oh God, Pastor, what is your own? Eh? I mean, how are you going to call? Because in your own area, in that your own house, you are the owner of that particular territory. You are the lord of that particular territory. And that territory belongs to you. And you have total control of that particular place. If you cannot, that the things that are in that house cannot tell you how, nobody can come and tell you how to run your house. Or nobody should be able to come into your house and tell you how to run your house. And God is the owner of the universe. The Bible says he spoke the universe into existence. If he demands that the universe, the creation of his hands, should pay allegiance to him, is that unreasonable? Is that unreasonable? Is it unreasonable for me to expect you to have control over your own property? Is it unreasonable? No. So that is one of the things you must understand, that those who walk with the Lord, number one, must obey the law of sovereign authority. And what is the law of sovereign authority? The law of sovereign authority simply states that God is in control over his creation. He rules and governs the affairs of his creation, and God's creation enjoy a fruitful relationship with their creator when they recognize, when they submit, and when they live in accordance with his dictate. In other words, you are going to enjoy your walk with God. You are going to enjoy your fellowship with him when you recognize that he is God. Number two, when you submit to him and when you live in accordance with his words. In other words, God says, sit, you sit. God says, stand, you stand. God says, jump, you say, how high. That is the way you walk with him. But if God says, sit, and you say, why? He says, move, you say, why? At one point in time, God will begin to, who is the boss here? Eh? Who is the boss here? Because you have to be able to be submissive to the Almighty God. In other words, the law of sovereign authority therefore states that God is God no matter how you feel about it. Your feeling is irrelevant. God is God. The law of sovereign authority says that God has power and authority. God's power and authority are absolute. It doesn't matter whether you recognize it or you don't even recognize it. God's law and power and authority, they are absolute. If God says that it should be night today, there's nothing you can do about it. That is the power and the authority of the Almighty God. It's absolute. Number three, the law of sovereign authority says that God's word is law. In other words, you can attempt to change it. You can attempt to challenge it. You can attempt to ignore it, but it doesn't make any difference. When the Lord says that the soul that sins shall die, whether you believe it or you don't believe it, doesn't matter. If you commit sin, you are going to die. It's as simple as that. The Bible makes us to understand that if after death there is judgment. Whether you believe it or you don't believe it, it doesn't make any difference. When you die, you will realize it. The point we are making is that God's word is law, and that is the law of sovereign authority. The law of sovereign authority says God owns everything. If you read the book of Psalms, the Bible tells the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Whether you believe it or you don't believe it, it doesn't make any difference. You can put your names on the building. You can monogram your name on your shirt. You can buy land. You can buy whatever you want to buy. The day you close your eyes in death, you are not taking it anywhere. It still belongs to him. God owns everything. That's the basic rule of the law of sovereign authority. And then finally, God has supreme authority. God has supreme authority, which means that every one of us, as we are sitting down here today, we are going to give final accounting. Whether you believe it or you don't believe it, doesn't make any difference. The day you close your eyes in death, you are going to stand before him in judgment. And the question now is that, is he going to welcome you or is he going to rebuke you? That is the question. So the law of sovereign authority says God is the supreme and the final ruler. Now that we have a general understanding of the law of sovereign authority, there are seven principles upon which this law sits upon. For you to be able to obey this law, you must understand seven principles. The first one that you need to understand is that the principle of absolute power and authority. When you know that God has all the power, when you know that God has all the authority, it doesn't make sense for you to start arguing with him. If you know that somebody, it's just like when you go, okay, this example, for those of us who are here in the U.S., you will not understand. But for those of us who come from Africa, who actually went through the process of going to the embassy to get a visa, you will understand this particular illustration. If you go and you are talking to a consular officer, you want to go to a particular country, you present your passport, you are looking for a visa. The guy looks at you and says, what are you going to do there? And then you give a reason, and he tells you your reason is not good enough, and you want to argue with him. You can argue from now to tomorrow. If the guy does not give you visa, there's nothing you can do. I hope you know that. And if you get to the airport, and you want to get to the airport, maybe JFK or whatever airport that you're coming to get into this country, you present your passport and the immigration officer looks at you and says, no, you are not coming in. There is nothing you can do. You can argue that, yes, I bought tickets. You can argue that the ticket cost a lot of money. You can argue that I did. If he tells you are not coming in, you are not coming in. That is authority. That is power. What we are saying now is that you're talking about God. Jesus Christ said that you should be afraid of the person who is able to kill not just the body, but the spirit. In other words, who is able to deal with your physical body is not as important as the person who can deal with your spirit. God has the final authority. When you understand that, it's easy for you to be submissive to him. Number two, the principle that the law sits upon is the principle of ownership. And what do we mean by ownership? We said the other time in Psalm 24, the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. The principle of ownership says God owns everything. When you know that God owns everything, it is very easy for you to release what he gives you back unto him. It's very easy for you to put everything on the table and say, Lord, everything belongs unto you. It's very easy for you to offer yourself because it belongs to him. Okay? If I give you something, I say, my brother, hold this cup for me. And then I come back 30 minutes later, I say, give me back my cup. Since you know the cup belongs to me, it shouldn't be a problem for you to release it. But if you don't know, if for some reason you assume that the cup belongs to you because I asked you to keep it for me, if I want that cup back, it becomes a problem because you are not going to be able to release it. The same thing when you are walking with God. If you understand the principle of ownership, if you understand that everything that we have access to, everything that we enjoy is from God, it makes it easy for you to be able to release it. It makes it easy for you to be able to relate, you know, to be able to walk with that thing because you understand the principle of ownership. Number three, the principle of privilege. The principle of privilege. Acts number 5, reading from verse number 41, the Bible said they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for the Almighty God. In other words, what that principle is saying is that God allows us to have, you know, God allows us to enjoy what he has made available to us. It is not a right, it is a privilege to enjoy what we have. For those of us who pray, who normally watch me pray here, I say something here and I say that Thank you for the privilege of life. The reason we pray like that is because you don't have a right to it. God can turn it off like that, and there's nothing you can do about it. I say we have a privilege of health. There are people in the hospital today. It's not because you are better than them. It's not because you are more holy. It's not because you know how to pray. It's just the mercy of the Almighty God. And that's what the Bible tells us in the book of Lamentation. He said, were it not for the mercy of God, we would have been consumed. So we need to understand the principle of privilege. God gives you the privilege for you to be here. God gives you the privilege for you to enjoy what you enjoy. God gives you the privilege for you to have access to what you have access to. God gives you the privilege for you to do the things that you do. That is why, that is one of the principles upon which the law of sovereign authority rests upon. Number four is the principle of priority. The principle of priority. The Bible tells us in the book of Matthew chapter 8. He said, but Jesus said unto him, follow me and let the dead bury their dead. In other words, if you are going to walk with God, you make God number one in your life. For those of us who are, you know, if you have ever been to a marriage, seminar, they will always tell you, when you get married, you leave your husband, the man and the woman will leave their parents and they will cling to each other. And they say that normally problem comes in a marriage when, instead of the two of them, husband and wife, coming together, they bring a third party in there. Either they bring their mother, they bring their father, they bring their sister, they bring their friends, they put it in between. And as soon as you put the third party in there, trouble starts. That means you do not understand the law of priority. If you don't understand the law of priority, your marriage is going to suffer. If you don't understand the law of priority, your relationship with God will suffer. If you don't understand the law of priority, your work will suffer. The reason is that you have to put the first thing first. And that's why God says, I am the Lord your God. Do not have any other God before me. In other words, I must be number one in your life. Not your work, not your husband, not your wife, not your family, not your ambition, not your career. I must be number one. If you are going to obey the law of sovereign authority, you must understand the law of priority. You must understand the principle of priority. You must put God first at all times. And then number, I don't even know. The next number. You must understand the principle of obedience. There's no way you can obey God. There's no way you can follow God if you don't understand the principle of obedience. If you are not willing to say, yes, Lord. If you don't understand the principle of saying, Father, whatever you say, I will do. If you don't understand the principle of obedience, you cannot walk with God. It's not possible. And then finally, you have to understand the principle of submission. Submission simply says that submit yourself therefore unto God. James chapter 4. Submit yourself therefore unto God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. In other words, you have to come and say, Lord, have your way in my life. If you cannot say, Lord, have your way in my life, then you can't walk with him. Okay? Submission. If he is Lord, then he must have you. Then we have no right. And we are under his control and direction at every point in time. And then finally is what is called the principle of stewardship. The principle of stewardship. 1 Peter chapter 4, reading from verse number 10. As every man has received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. In other words, if you know that God owns everything, whatever he gives to you does not belong to you. He gives you as a manager. Manage that particular resources. And that simply means that you take whatever he gives you, you manage it properly, so that when he comes to ask you question, you can give a good accounting. So the principle of stewardship, you must understand it if you are going to walk with God. If God owns everything, it means we give up our personal ownership and we embrace the concept of stewardship when we're working with him. What does that mean? If you look in the Garden of Eden, the Bible makes us understand that when Adam was placed in there, Adam was supposed to tend the garden. Adam was supposed to maintain the garden. The garden does not belong unto Adam. The garden belongs unto God. But Adam was put in there as a steward to maintain it. The money that God gives you, the resources that he gives you, the talents that he gives you, everything that God gives you opportunity to have, he gives to you so that you can manage it, so that you can develop it, so that you can use it for the blessings of other people, so that when he comes, he's going to ask you, what did you do with it? And we see that example in the parable of the talent. Bible says that Jesus Christ, when he was going away, he gave, you know, when the Lord was going away, he gave his people 5, 2, and 1 talent. And when he came back, he asked them for accounting. What did you do with the talent that he gave you? What did you do with your ability? What did you do with the gift to pray? What did you do with your gifts of singing? What did you do with your gifts of administration? This is the principle of stewardship. If you don't understand it, you cannot be submissive to the Almighty God. Okay? So now that we have seen the underlying principle, the question is, why do we need this particular law in the first place? Why do we need that supreme authority? Why do we need to be subject under him in the first place? Why? Number one, like I said earlier on, it defines your relationship with God. Because when you are subject unto him, you know where you stand, you know how he relates with you. Number two, it sets boundaries and expectation. There are some things that only God can do. And there are some things that only you can do. I remember during the time of our life class, our brother was talking about the fact that you have to put on the whole armor of God. Say, God has made that armor available unto you. You have to put it on. God is not going to put it on for you. Okay? If you don't put it on, what happened? You are on your own. It doesn't mean that the battle of the enemy will stop. No. It simply means that you are going to be open. There are certain things that God will do. There are certain things that you will do. The law of sovereign authority simply tells us these are the boundaries. These are the expectations. Number three, the laws of sovereign authority, the reason we need it is because it outlines our roles and our responsibilities. There are certain things that we must do. There are certain things that we are responsible for. And then number four, it tells us, it highlights the benefit of compliance. If you do certain things, God will do certain things. The Bible says if you move closer to him, he will move closer to you. Okay? But if you don't move, God will not move. There's something that we used to say back home, or some of the elders in the faith we used to say. They say that our God is a God that will look at you and look at you and look at you until you do something. That's not the correct translation from the language. But for those who understand, maybe they will help me. They say, Oluawa Obawonipani. I don't know how to translate that into English. But that simply means that God is the one that look at you and look at you. If you do something, he will act. If you don't do anything, he will keep looking at you. Okay? And that is why you find out that when people pray, God bless me, God bless me, you find out that if they don't do anything, they're not going to get blessed. Because God will not break the ceiling and pour blessing in half. He won't do it. You will have to bless something in your hand. And that is why, if you remember, when the Lord Jesus Christ, when people came to him and they asked him, Lord, do something, he said, what is in your hand? When that particular woman, that widow of that prophet came, he said, my sons are going to be put into, they're about to be taken into captivity. He said, do something. He said, what is in your house? In other words, there has to be something in your hand for God to bless. If you read the book of Joshua chapter 1, the Bible says, whenever the sole of your feet shall tread upon, he said, there will I give unto you. In other words, if you don't tread on anything, you are not getting anything. Okay? So the benefit of the kingdom is a function of your compliance. There are certain things you must do to get the answer. If you don't do it, you won't get the result. Yeah. Simple. God is not partial. God does not answer my prayer because I'm me. Okay? Or I'm this good looking. No. That's not why he answers my prayer. He answers the prayer because I pray. And he will answer your prayer if you pray. But if you refuse to pray, the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. And then we need the law because it spells out the consequences. You cannot say that you don't know. That's why the Lord opens the scriptures and shows you there are certain things you must do and there are certain things you must not do. If you do certain things, you will get the answer. If you do certain things, you will not get the answer. That is the way it works. Okay? Now, there are many who have problem with this idea of submission to the Almighty God. They have a problem with it. They just cannot see themselves bowing themselves down to God. Just like Pharaoh, who say, who is the Lord that I should obey him? There are people like that who will say, who is the Lord? If they tell them God says you should do this, that is exactly the thing that they are not going to do. As long as God said do it, they will not do it. So if you want to get them to do something, you tell them God said you should not do it. Then they will do it. Because they like to go in the opposite direction. You see? But before I attempt to tell you why people don't like the law of the, why people don't like authority, let me ask you this question. Why are people always defiant of authority? Why do they hate any authority figure? There are people today who are so opposed to the police. Why? There are people today who are so opposed to people in higher authority. Why? The first thing is the issue of trust. When you don't trust somebody, you are not going to obey that person. When you don't believe that that person has your best interest at heart, you will not obey that person. There are people who don't even want any form of control in their life. There are people who are just defiant. There are people who refuse to acknowledge authority. So the question is, why do we have issues with divine authority? Why? The first issue is that people are afraid of absolute authority. If I am the king of the jungle, and everything that I say goes, and nobody can question me, there are people who are very, very uncomfortable with that, because I can abuse it. But they fail to understand that I am not God. I'm a human being, which means it's open to abuse. The same thing, but for God, God is the almighty God, and he has the final authority. There is no point fighting him. Number two, why do people have problem with authority? It's because they equate a holy God with an unholy man. They have seen the abuse of power. They have seen people who have power, what they do with it. And they equate that same thing with the holy God. They fail to understand that there's a difference between God and man. And that's why the Bible tells us that my ways are not your ways, as the east is far from the west. You know, so there's a lot of difference between man and God. You cannot even compare. So when you have a wrong view of God, you will have a problem with his authority. Number three, people have embraced a wrong philosophy. When you believe that man is the measure of all things, when you believe that you are the center of the universe, when you believe that everything revolves around you, how would you wake up one day and say, no, you are no longer the special person? When every morning, the morning when you are going to kindergarten, your mother looks at you and says, you are the best thing that ever happened. You are very, very beautiful. The world will stop working if you don't show up. If you don't smile, the sun will not come up. And then you wake up one day, you get to high school, somebody starts telling you are ugly. You say, no, they bully me. And then it becomes a problem. And then somebody now comes and says, there is a God. You have a major issue, because every day of your life, you have been told that you are the best thing that ever happened after sliced bread. That's what I've been told every day. Now that reality hits, you have difficulty accepting it. The issue is that many have embraced the wrong philosophy of life. They have difficulty obeying the laws of God. And then finally, when we do not understand the love of God, when you do not understand the love of God, what happens? You will have difficulty submitting yourself unto him. A woman or a man who does not understand the love that his wife or his husband or the husband have for him or her will have difficulty trusting that man. If you know that your husband loves you, or you know that your wife loves you, what you will find is that it will be very, very easy for you to submit and to do whatever he wants you to do. Okay? But if you don't trust that guy, if you look at him and say, this guy, when he goes to work, he keeps winking, or when he goes to work, when you don't trust the guy, if the man tells you certain things, you are saying this so that you want to keep me under. You are saying this so that I will not enjoy this. You will begin to suspect that person. But when you have access to the love of God, when you understand the love of God, what happened is this. You will begin to respect. You will have no problem submitting yourself unto him. Jesus Christ, when he was speaking to the Jewish people, he said, in Luke 19, he said, if thou hast known, he was talking about Jerusalem there. Say, if thou hast known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things which belong to thy peace. In other words, if you know what is good for you, if you know what has been in store for you, instead you will do, your attitude will change. If you know, if you have experienced the love of God, if you have experienced the touch of God, your attitude changes. If you notice, the people who are evangelists, the very, very fiery evangelists, if you check their background, these are the people who have done the worst things. These are people who have committed the worst crimes. And then one day they encounter Christ. The day they encounter Christ, you will notice that their life changes around. Their attitude changes. Their fervor changes. Their zeal changes. They are the most passionate. Why? Because they know that they were heading down the tube until God pulled them out. But for somebody who has always been religious all his life, when you tell them about the love of God, they say, yeah, the love of God, yeah, because they have not seen it. When you don't know the love of God, it's difficult for you to submit unto him. And then finally, people have problem with the authority of God when they just simply refuse and they are defiant. They just hate authority over their lives. They just look at you and say, I am not going to obey. And this is what we find in Exodus chapter 5, verse 2. They say, Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let him go. In other words, I don't care what you call yourself, whether you are God or whatever you call yourself. I don't obey you. I don't know you. There are people who do that. Anytime they hear the word God, they do the exact opposite. So that is why people don't. You know, That is why people don't they don't submit to authority. The next thing that I want to just quickly look at now is this: what happens when you violate the law of sovereign authority? What happens? The first thing that happens is that you cut yourself away from his blessings. Number two is that you incur his wrath. Number three is that you make yourself an enemy of the Almighty God. And number four is that you walk contrary to his purpose. The Bible says, I know the thought that I think towards you, that the thought of good and not of evil, to give you an expected end. There is a particular end that God has in store for every one of his children. And if you refuse, if you are defiant, if you are opposed to him, you will walk contrary to his purposes for your life. The question then is, how then do you benefit from the law? You benefit from the law because the law strengthens. When you submit yourself to the Almighty God, you strengthen your walk with him. You strengthen your walk with him. Number two, you rest your soul because you know he takes care of you. Number three is that you rest your mind because you know that nothing can, you know what you can control, you know what you cannot control. And then number four is that it establishes your heart because you know that nothing can touch you except the Lord God Almighty allows it. And then it sustains you because you know the person who knows the end from the very beginning. The issue about submission to the Almighty God is about one simple fact, and that is the issue of humility. Are you humble enough to know, to be able to submit yourself before him? Are you humble enough to know when God says you are wrong, to say, yes, I am wrong? Are you humble enough to say, yes, I don't know how to order my life, Lord, order my life for me? Are you humble enough to say, I'm willing, O God Almighty, to follow whatever direction that you give to me? That is all boils down to the issue of humility. The question now is this: is humility going to stand in your way of the blessings that God has in store for those who follow him? That's the question. Because you have to make up your mind. Do I want to follow God, or do I want to continue to oppose him? Do I want to follow God, or do I want to continue to have my way? You have had your way for so many years. What difference has it made? Okay? You have done your own thing the way you wanted to do it, the way you want to do your own thing. What difference has it made to your life up till now? And that is the question. Because if we are going to move forward, you have to do something different. If you are going to benefit from working with the Almighty God or be called a Christian, you have to do something different. And it starts by recognizing him as the Lord and the final authority over your life. Let's bow our heads as we talk to the Almighty God this morning. Today we are going to do some prayers, but I want you to first of all just talk to the Almighty God and say, what is it that will stand in the way of God's promises for my life? What is it that will stand in the way of his mercies, that will stand in the way of his blessings, that will stand in the way of all the things that he has said he's going to do in my life? What is it? Is it pride? Is it a haughty spirit? Is it a form of defiance? Is it the lack of humility? What is it? Is it not being able to receive the correction of the Almighty God? Is it not being, is it that particular issue of not being able to say, yes, Lord, I am wrong? What is it that will stand in the way of the promises of God for your life? Especially now as we come to the end of another year. I want you to talk to the Almighty God and just say, Lord, here I am. Whatever it is, O God, whatever it is that will not allow me to receive the best of what you have in store for me, that will not allow me to have the heavens open over my life, I pray, Lord, this very morning, begin to purge me, O God, in Jesus' name. Open your mouth and just talk to the Almighty God.